So today we're going to talk about humans. Yesterday we spent all day talking about humans. We had a fantastic seminar. And what we're going to do today is bring you three of the talks from yesterday's seminar that are kind of highlights of it. And hopefully whet your appetite for further discussion about research involving the human side of security and privacy. And you know, if we do interest you in it, you are invited to, first of all, read some really interesting research papers. All of our presenters will mention some of their research papers, which are up on their website. But you can also take a look at yesterday's seminar. All of those slides are available, and I believe the videos will soon be available. So for those of you interested in learning more about this area, which I personally think is fascinating, hopefully you will too, we do have resources for you. Mic closer. All right, is that better? Okay, excellent. Okay, so what we did yesterday is we broke the area down into kind of three sub-areas. We spent some time talking about how to understand the human element in security and privacy. Then we talked about some emerging threats. And then in our third panel, we talked about some of the tools and approaches that we're using to try to address some of these issues. So today we have one speaker from each of those sessions. So we're going to start out with understanding users. And our first speaker is Emilee Rader from Michigan State University.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Great. So I'm going to be talking today about how people make decisions and think about and learn about security and privacy. So everybody who uses computing technology has to make decisions about security basically on a daily basis, whether they actually know that they're making decisions about security or not. So these decisions involve things like how to handle a phishing email. This is an example of a phishing email that we received a couple of years ago at Michigan State University. They include whether to install a software update or not. It seems like every day I have like 10 more apps that I need to update. What password to choose. And if it's a good idea to say yes to the various app permission requests or not. Each of these decisions is an opportunity for the user to protect herself and other people from security and privacy threats. And I chose these particular examples because they're all decisions that people have to make for themselves. So automatic spam filtering can basically be too aggressive and filter mails that you really would have wanted to see into your spam, and then you just have to basically go check your spam folder anyway. Software updates can be interruptive, and people really do need the freedom to be able to choose when they want those updates to be installed. Assigning people difficult to memorize passwords is not really an effective strategy. People are just going to write them down anyway, usually in a way that's fairly insecure. And it's really important for privacy for people to be able to exert some kind of control over the data that apps are collecting about them. So basically what I'm saying is we can't remove the user from all security decisions. And this means that a system's security depends not just on technical approaches, but also on the choices that are made by the people that use these systems. So basically in my work, I'm interested in where and how people are learning the things that they know about security so that we can potentially help them make better decisions when they do have to make these choices. One challenge, though, is that it's actually really, really hard for people to learn from their past experiences with security. So unlike touching a hot stove, it's not like there's immediate feedback that people can sort of see something has gone wrong and then make changes to what they know and make different decisions. So a good example of this, I think, was last month, the company Nest started basically locking people out of their accounts because their passwords had shown up as compromised on other systems. And so you can sort of ask yourself, well, what did people learn from this, really, about passwords? Probably nothing, because they didn't know necessarily which of their passwords and what account the compromise had taken place on. So people take experiences like this, whether they're easy to learn from or not, that they've had in the past, and they use them to figure out what to do in the future when they find themselves in unfamiliar situations. So this is something that we're all doing all the time. It happens unconsciously and automatically. We take what's happened to us in the past and we use it to basically predict the future. That wasn't me. We basically call these kind of heuristics and rules of thumb that people are learning all the time folk theories. They are informal, causal, explanatory theories that basically develop out of people's everyday experiences with technology. And they're really, really helpful because they help people envision what might happen in the future and then figure out how to act in those situations. But one problem is that they're incomplete because people don't have comprehensive experience with everything they might need to know. And they're also not necessarily technically accurate. So for example, one privacy-related folk theory that I've been encountering a lot in my work lately is that basically end users seem to expect benevolence from the companies that they give their data to. And this basically means that, for better or for worse, they make decisions assuming that those companies won't do anything with the data that they themselves wouldn't want those companies to do with the data. So they expect companies to behave in ways that are consistent with their expectations. And there's actually an example of this that I came across just yesterday, which is that people are accusing Facebook of basically taking phone numbers provided for two-factor authentication and then allowing them to be searched on the system based on those phone numbers. And this is a case where expectations are being violated. So there's actually a big difference between the folk theories of sort of regular users and experts. We found this out when we did a study where we did an automatic topic analysis of a bunch of documents that we collected from different sources. So we collected stories that people had heard from other people about security. We collected web pages from the internet that contained advice that was basically written by experts. And we also collected a corpus of news articles that were about security-related topics. And so what you see on the slide here is basically a network graph of all of these documents. So each little dot on the slide is a document, and the lines connecting them are documents that had basically topics that were related in them. And then they're clustered together according to documents that were similar to each other. So you can kind of see that the documents clustered according to similar sources. So news articles were more similar to each other than they were to the expert advice and to the stories from the end users. So the blue ones are the news articles, the green ones are the web pages from experts, and the red ones are the stories from the regular users, basically about the kinds of things that they worried about. So here's a sort of simplified version of that graph. So the size of the circles is how often those topics were mentioned, and the lines connecting them are basically how often two topics appeared together. And what you can see from this is a slide that's showing the stories from the regular users. They basically talked about things like attack types and who might have been conducting the attack, so hackers and things like viruses and stuff like that. But the web pages that were written by the experts talked way more about types of attacks and then possible defenses. So they didn't really mention who might be conducting the attacks at all. And the news articles didn't really talk about any of that stuff very much. They tended to talk about things that were newsworthy, like criminal hacking and data breaches and things like that. So if we're going to compare these information sources, we can basically learn about what's important to the people who wrote them or what they think is important to the audience about communicating to them about security. So the stories from the regular users were more about sort of agency and who might be trying to harm them. Whereas the stories from the experts were more about method and prevention, so how the attacks were happening and what kinds of things you could do to prevent them. And then the news articles were more about consequences for society. And so for us, basically, we took away from this that the sort of regular users are more concerned about who might be trying to hurt them because they were using that information kind of to estimate and predict whether they might be likely to be a victim. Whereas the experts are trying to provide these technical mechanisms for people to protect themselves, but they're kind of missing an opportunity to connect with the end users on the stuff that the end users are actually really caring about and worried about. So I talked about how experts and regular users think differently about security, but when else are folk theories important? So there's a couple of other ways that we've been finding in our research. We've found that folk theories are important when people are learning from experience, because they're fitting their new experiences into their existing folk theories. When people are trying to choose a predictive action to take, they're using their folk theories to help them decide what to do. And when people are consenting to data collection, they're using their beliefs and expectations about what might happen to their data to basically guide their decision making about what to do and what to allow. So I'm going to give an example of each of these. So first I want to talk about software updates. One trend, basically, is to remove control from the user completely and automatically update. So the user has no choice in terms of when these things happen. So we did a project where we talked to people about what they thought was going on in their computers related to software updates, and then we actually collected log data from their machines. These were Windows 7 machines, about when the updates were happening, whether they were automatic or manual, and sort of what the settings were. And we found that often the settings on the machine didn't actually match people's intentions. And so in many of the cases that we spoke to, they actually believed that they would be notified when there was an update that was ready for them, that they would then go and manually install. But actually, their computers were set to automatically update. So you would think that this is sort of a victory for security, right? Because they're automatically updating and the user doesn't have to do anything. But what we found was that these people were actually wanting to be notified so they could do it themselves. And at least according to their stated intentions, they would have actually done it sooner than the automatic update, which is typically delayed a little bit. And so since machines tend to be more vulnerable, sort of closer to the time of release of a new update, this actually meant that there was a longer delay to install them than the people said would have happened. And it also turns out that people generalize what they learn from one system to another. So we had several examples of people who were like, I updated this thing, and it completely wrecked my functionality, and now I never want to install another update again. So this is another way that people can learn things in one system and kind of generalize them to the other system. But the really important takeaway for us was that basically by making software updates invisible, it made the behavior seem like it was unexpected, and also it didn't provide people an opportunity to learn from their system about what was going on. So they really had no way to basically develop new mental models and new folk theories about updates because they were invisible. So in another study, we did a survey of 2,000 US adults, internet users, where we asked them about aspects of their folk theories and also about security-related actions that they'd taken to see if there was any kind of relationship between aspects of their folk theories and their security-related behaviors. And so what we found was that people who believed that they themselves could be a target of hackers were much more likely to say that they had taken protective action against hackers. And people who said that they believed that computer viruses caused visible, noticeable problems on their computer were much more likely to actually say that they used antivirus. So from this, our takeaway was that people whose folk theories involve some kind of risk or harm to themselves or visible problem were much more likely to sort of make the extra effort or at least say that they were making an extra effort to protect themselves. But people that like thought they could just catch a virus from browsing the internet and there was nothing they could do were less likely to say that they were protecting themselves. So there's one more area that I want to talk about where folk theories are important for people, and that's privacy. People are expected to manage their own digital privacy basically by making upfront decisions about consenting to data collection practices. And when they're making these choices, they're using their expectations about what they think might happen to guide their decision making. So we interviewed a bunch of people who use fitness trackers, which are basically devices that use sensors like optical heart rate sensors and GPS and accelerometers to collect data about physical movement and location. And they talked to us about what kinds of information they were aware that these devices were collecting. So they focused on things that are basically visible to them in the user interface, like step counts and like heart rate and like the map of where they had gone on a run. But nobody talked about how their fitness tracker knew where they lived. And so we took away from this that basically the information that's provided in the user interface is really, really strongly influences what people think that systems are doing. So perhaps if we had put a little icon on the map that said Susie's house, it might have been more obvious to them that that was a potential inference from this data. So the visibility of data that's collected and inferences that are made are important for privacy decisions. So what does all this mean? I'm sort of arguing that hiding security and privacy from users isn't necessarily always the best approach if you want them to be able to learn from their past experiences. So it's important for practitioners that are designing processes and systems to think about the decision points where it's really important to include users, like authentication and software updates and consent. And then basically design feedback that provides opportunities for people to learn from these kinds of things so they can incorporate them into their existing folk theories and hopefully make better decisions. And then I just want to leave you with this quote as sort of food for thought. It's a quote from Willett Kempton, who's an anthropologist who has studied the role of folk theories for things like energy use and climate change, which actually have some very similar properties to thinking about security. So he says, technical experts will evaluate folk theory from the perspective of correctness, not by asking whether it fulfills the needs of the folk. But it's the latter criterion on which sound public policy must be based. And so I just want to raise this point to sort of urge you to think about how to work with people in the context of what they already know and provide feedback for learning about security. Thank you.
Thank you. So our next speaker is Apu Kapadia, who is a professor at Indiana University, Bloomington.
Testing? All right. Okay, so yeah, thanks for the introduction. I'll be talking about some of our research in the context of cameras and photography today. So I don't think any of you will disagree that cameras are everywhere now, but this is a fairly recent phenomenon. These photos show two inauguration ceremonies of the Pope. In 2005, there were still two more years until the iPhone would be announced. And you don't see very many cameras. In 2013, photography had officially become ubiquitous. Okay, but that was so 6 years ago, right? So since then, industry and academia have been experimenting with new kinds of photography. For example, the narrative clip and the autographer were two early experiments in recording your day or life-logging your day. You could wear these and they would automatically take photos, for example, every 30 seconds. Google Glass was another kind of wearable camera that inspired photography from a first-person view. Now, unfortunately, most of these projects didn't succeed. But people keep trying, right? So in 2016, Snapchat introduced their funky Snapchat spectacles that you could use at parties and then sync video to their app. In 2017, Google introduced their version of a life-logging camera called Google Clips, described as the smart camera that snaps short clips for you. Now, some of you may be wondering why anybody would use such cameras to begin with. Okay, well, why not? You could log your entire day. You could document interesting moments that may not have been possible with traditional cameras. And note the photographer's hands appear in most of these photos. Or document police encounters with body cams, or use this device as a memory aid. Right, so good applications. But despite these great applications, how will these cameras affect our privacy? Nissenbaum introduces the concept of contextual integrity, saying that privacy violations can occur when accepted norms of collection in a particular context suddenly change. In this case, we are not yet used to other people wearing cameras and taking photos in the background, as opposed to someone holding a camera up. You may end up with numerous photos of places that you would normally not photograph, like bathrooms or your messy living room. And with rampant sharing of photos on social media, the change in norms of where these photos end up could also signal a violation of contextual integrity. In addition to privacy concerns of people captured by these cameras, the wearer of these cameras can be greatly affected too. So Goffman talks about how managing the impressions we cast on people is an important aspect of our privacy. For example, how we manage our own personas at work versus in social settings. But our life logs can tell a detailed story about what we eat, watch, say, whom we meet, where we go. So there is reason, good reason, for life loggers themselves to be worried about their privacy. With such photography gaining traction, our everyday physical interactions are more likely to be captured by cameras and transmitted widely across social media. Our physical privacy may no longer be sacred. And we wondered what malware could do if it infected such a device, or even just your smartphone, which could be turned into a life logger. So it turns out such photos are often ill-composed and blurry and are hard to make sense of, like the photos on the right. We wondered if an attacker could create a 3D model of the room to make more sense of the victim's environment. We conducted a study with participants carrying such a device in a control setting and found that we could build pretty decent 3D models from these photos, as illustrated by this short video. So navigating this model, you can get a pretty good sense of the 3D structure of the environment. But you can't, for example, see enough detail of the desk or, say, the whiteboard. Our tool lets you zoom in and click a region of interest and then brings up the relevant underlying photos of the region. And then, you know, perhaps you can clearly see what's on the whiteboard. Okay, so that's just a quick demo. So after examining these threats, our main question as privacy researchers was how we could address privacy in the context of such cameras. And my colleagues and I set out to answer three major questions. First, what makes an image sensitive? Is there anything about this photo that might signal a privacy violation if shared publicly? And if we begin to understand what makes an image sensitive, we could then build algorithms to detect these aspects and hopefully prevent many, even if not all, privacy violations. And if we detect parts of the image that are sensitive, what do we do then? We could simply not share the image or delete it, but we could also try to obscure these regions. So before I discuss some of our major highlights, I just wanted to quickly thank the National Science Foundation, which was a major sponsor of our research. And I'd like to thank Google and Indiana University as well. Also note the important caveat below that, you know, nothing I present here should be taken to necessarily reflect their views. Okay, so to answer our first question of what makes an image sensitive, we ran a user study to understand how people would use life logging cameras or how they would choose to share life logging photos. We recruited 36 students at Indiana University to wear our own version of a life logging device. Our device captured photos every 5 minutes, and overall we captured 15,000 images. Of course, privacy was a great concern, and it took us many months to design safeguards in consultation with the legal and ethical folks at IU. Just some examples shown here. These cameras were worn in bright red lanyards with a warning that photography was in progress. Each participant was briefed one-on-one with a do's and don'ts list. People were given business cards to hand out to concerned bystanders if they wanted, for example, their photos to be removed. The app on the device could be used to pause collection and, importantly, retroactively delete photos in case you forgot to pause collection. But anyway, of our many findings, I'll focus on the reasons people gave for not wanting to share some of their life logging photos. The yellow stickers indicate our work that I'll highlight in the rest of this talk. You'll notice that almost a third of the time, people didn't want to share photos because of an object in the photo. Most of the time, this was a screen, but sometimes it was a phone showing texting while driving, or a coffee mug for a secret coffee habit, or photos relating to smoking or alcohol. The next most cited reason was the place where the photo was taken, depicting a private space such as a bedroom or a bathroom. The other two reasons I wanted to highlight was that often participants didn't want to share a photo that would violate someone else's privacy. And this finding gives hope that you can indeed rely on the sense of propriety of the camera owner, like someone wearing Google Glass, to respect the privacy of others. In this talk, you'll see some ideas of how we might try to leverage the sense of propriety. Based on these findings, we devised algorithms to detect sensitive parts of a photo. First, we decided to try to detect sensitive spaces through our system called Place Avoider. Our approach took two general properties of the image. The first is to look for landmarks that are unique to a particular room. For example, at work, plumbing fixtures might be unique to the bathroom. A generic light switch may not be so unique. We also looked for more global features, such as lighting profiles. This information can be combined and also reconciled with a mobility model to make better predictions. We tested this approach in 5 different spaces, 3 houses, 2 workspaces, trying to detect photos from a particular room marked as sensitive. Overall, we found high accuracy in houses and workplaces with more clutter and uniqueness, with accuracy getting as high as 99% in some of these optimistic cases. What you see are 5 precision recall curves that illustrate how one might tune the algorithm to trade off recall, as in how many bathroom photos did you actually detect versus precision. Of the ones you thought to be bathroom photos, how many were actually bathroom photos? The point being, if you're more paranoid, you can sacrifice some precision to improve recall. Place avoider does well with this trade-off when there is much more visual diversity. So by then, deep learning had started gaining traction, and we wondered how well deep learning could detect screens. So we threw almost 20,000 images at the deep learning algorithm and tested it with about 2,000 images, half of which had screens. To our amazement, we missed only one screen, and that's the image right there in the bottom left. And the algorithm produced 3 false positives relating to printed text, as you can see. We trained the model to detect one specific monitor in this case, and it learned that really well, and that's good. But we wondered how well this same model would detect photos with screens in our life logging data set. This is the data set where students captured those real life photos for a week and had a variety of screens belonging to different people. And with 92% accuracy, this precision recall curve looks pretty good if you're a glass is half full kind of person like me. For life loggers who capture many thousands of photos a day, a conservative filter with 95% recall and 60% precision would still leave enough non-screen photos to make your photo albums. Well, okay, our next question is, what do we do once we've detected screens or these other items? Perhaps the sensitive portions can be redacted. But will anybody really want to use these transforms that probably make your photos look ugly? Do you want to be known as that geek who shares redacted photos on social media? So we set out to catalog transforms that were both effective at obscuring sensitive content, but were also aesthetically pleasing to the viewers. We ran an online experiment where for various transforms, participants rated photos for their aesthetics and also tried to identify various types of content, such as the age of the person, their expression, or the type of an object. Overall, we found various combinations where redactions provided high enough aesthetics as well as privacy. For example, using a silhouetted transform for obscuring documents or clothing, or blurring to hide age seemed to provide a good trade-off. However, pixelation for indoor spaces or using an edge filter looked really ugly to some people, as you can see in the left photo, even if they did a good job with privacy. So we wondered whether we could compensate for the loss in aesthetics by boosting the aesthetics of the rest of the image, as you can see in the photo on the right. Unfortunately, we didn't find an effect with 3 particular so-called beautifying filters that we tried. So, a fun idea, but let's not give up. My cup is still half full, and maybe we can try harder. And we are actually running some other experiments. In general, what we're trying to do is make privacy fun, where people willingly and easily apply transforms that protect people's privacy without degrading the experience of the viewers. So I hope these few highlights of our research on cameras and photography raise some interesting questions for all of us to ponder. In particular, we need socio-technical solutions for socio-technical problems. With people taking photos of people and then sharing them with people, we do have to consider humans in the loop when it comes to photos and privacy. Can we leverage the sense of propriety in people in the power position of having just taken a photo? Can we nudge them or incentivize them to make decisions that protect other people's privacy? In collaboration with psychologists at IU, with support from the NSF, we seek to explore just that. And with cameras all around us, we might not even know when these things are on. Even LED indicators may not reflect reality. So in collaboration with privacy and HCI researchers at the University of Pittsburgh, we are exploring physical designs of sensors to convey a real, tangible sense of privacy to people. And now that we're entering an era where we can put a camera in just about anything, where do we draw the line? You can buy a toaster oven today that uses a camera to perfectly brown your toast, or an air conditioner that can monitor the positions of people in the room for optimal cooling, or rent a car with a GPS unit that has an inbuilt camera so that it can, actually, I don't know, do what exactly, I'm not sure. So what are the privacy implications of these killer apps? So I'll conclude with this slide as per our RSA tradition. Consider better discipline with cameras in your own home. Do you really need to check email in the bathroom, really? You know, although charity begins at home, take your mindset to work. Consider the threats of compromised cameras and microphones in the workplace. But in general, even though cameras can provide useful applications, maybe we should all slow down a little. As we move forward technically, let's do it carefully, responsibly, and ethically. Thank you.
All right. So our last speaker will be Lujo Bauer, who is a professor at Carnegie Mellon. And Lujo is going to talk with us about passwords. And he is going to attempt to summarize about 10 years of password research in 15 minutes. We'll see how well he succeeds.
And if Lorrie sounds a little bit incredulous, it's because I didn't quite succeed yesterday. hello, everybody. So I'll be talking about passwords. We are all very familiar with passwords. We probably all hate passwords with a passion. Probably we are relying on passwords a little bit less than we used to, because now we can log into our phone with our fingerprint or our face. But in many contexts, we haven't replaced passwords yet, and we won't for a good time to come. And so while we continue relying on passwords, it's really important that we figure out how to wield them as usably and as securely as possible. So as Lorrie said, I'll be talking about a decade's worth of research with many, many collaborators, including Lorrie here, during which we try to make a significant step forward in using passwords securely and usably. So what do we want from a password? We've known for a long time that in some sense, what makes a password good is that it is hard for an attacker to guess, while at the same time not be too painful to use. For a long time also, we've had some tools to try to accomplish this. For example, we've used password composition policies, which might say your password must be at least 8 characters or at least 12 characters, or have these 3 character classes or something else. There are other tools also, like guidance that people receive when they're creating a password that tells them their password is good or bad and why and what to do about it. There's also guidance that might be deployed before people try to create a password, such as a pamphlet they get when they start their new job that explains how important it is to create a password with certain characteristics. Now, what's been notably missing is a scientific methodology that would let us evaluate these tools, that would let us say, I have this idea for password composition policy, and I'd like to see whether it's better than what I'm using right now at my company. We didn't have an approach for doing that. And so for about a decade, we first sought to develop a scientific approach and then to use it to actually learn something about what makes passwords usable and secure, or what could make passwords usable and secure. Okay, so if we are after an empirical methodology, then like with any empirical methodology, we need 2 things. We need data, and then we need metrics using which we're going to measure something about that data. When we talk about metrics in the space of passwords, the 2 natural areas that we want to measure things about are the security and the usability of passwords. So for example, for usability, we might want to measure recall rates, how often people actually remember or forget their password. We might want to measure how long it takes them to type their password in. We might want to measure even how irritated they get to when they have to create a password under a particular password composition policy. Because if they're too irritated, they might just jump ship and go to a different service instead. Now, historically, password security has been measured with various information theoretic notions of entropy. But over the last decade, even before that, there's been some criticism of those in that they didn't really accurately reflect whether a password could be successfully guessed by an attacker. So I'll talk a bunch more about the security metrics. Once we have figured out the metrics using which to measure passwords, we also have to find some passwords to measure. This goes back to the previous question. I have two ideas for a password composition policy I want to deploy. I can't actually go and deploy both of them, or the 10 of them that I have in mind, and collect passwords under in each of these 10 deployments. I have to come up with some way before deploying this scheme in the real world to figure out what the effect of this scheme will be. So what researchers commonly do, for example, is we design online studies or lab studies. And in these studies, we invite people to create a password under a particular password composition policy or with a particular kind of feedback, and then we evaluate those passwords. But of course, these are not real passwords used for real accounts, and that begs the question, are any results we obtain in this way generalizable? Another approach is people looked at passwords that have been leaked on the internet, and then maybe they take the subset of those passwords that conforms to a password composition policy they want to test, and then they measure the security of those. But again, it's unclear whether those results are generalizable. And in this case, we don't even have any usability data because we don't know who are the people who are associated with these passwords. So I'll talk a little bit more about measuring security of passwords. Intuitively, again, the picture is fairly straightforward. A password is weak if it is easy for an attacker to guess that password. A password is strong if it is resilient to being guessed by an attacker. So the approach we settled on for measuring the strength of a password is to effectively simulate how long an attacker would take to guess that password if the attacker were trying to guess that password. Now that's of course much more easily said than done, because how do you know how long it would take an attacker to guess a password? So we conducted an experiment where we took four of the most popular password guessing tools and approaches. We tuned them in many, many ways, and then we compared them to how well a professional password recovery firm would guess a bunch of passwords. So we hired a professional password recovery firm, and we assumed that their ability to guess passwords would be about equivalent to the ability of an actual malicious attacker. So here are some results. This graph shows, for now, just the performance of the various automated guessing approaches. So each line is one of the automated guessing approaches. On the y-axis is the percent of the passwords in a set of passwords that has been successfully guessed. And on the x-axis is how long it took the attacker to get to that, to guess that fraction of passwords. So for example, if you look at the purple line, which is the topmost leftmost, and you look at the point on the x-axis where it's the attacker has made 10 to the ninth or about a billion guesses, then you can see on the y-axis that about 12% of the passwords in a particular set has been guessed. Another thing you can read from this graph is that the purple line, the top left one, represents a more effective guessing method than the blue line, the bottom right one, because almost all of the points on the purple line are to the left and higher than the points on the blue line. So that means that it has guessed more passwords and more quickly than the method represented by the blue line. Now, if we put in the performance of the human, the professional password recovery firm, we get this black line. And you see this black line is sometimes better than some of the automated approaches, sometimes it's not. But the really interesting takeaway is that if you count a password as guessed, as soon as it is guessed by any of the automated approaches, then you get this dotted or dashed green line. And that green line is always to the left of the black line. So that basically means that if we're interested in how quickly humans will be able to guess a password, then we can, and we don't have humans who will actually be trying to guess that password, then instead we can rely on whatever is the minimum number produced by this set of automated algorithms. And that number will always be safe. That is, the humans will never be able to guess the password more quickly than is indicated by this number. Okay, so now we kind of have a way to measure the security of passwords. Or do we really? One thing that I didn't talk about is this measurement efficient or not? And it turns out that a lot of the mechanisms that I talked about, they're too expensive in either space or time to use effectively. So like in many other areas, deep learning came to the rescue. I won't belabor the point, but it turns out we were able to design a deep neural network that was able to replicate what these algorithms on the previous slides were doing and do so quickly and efficiently. We also, if you're interested in playing around with this deep neural network, you can download it from GitHub. And for those of you who might be interested in understanding how strong some passwords are without actually calculating the strength yourself, we invite you to use our password guessability service at this URL, pgsecmuedu. So if you send us a bunch of passwords to which you have legitimate access, we can send you back how long it will take to guess those passwords using the suite of different methods that we talked about. All right, so now we know how to measure passwords, but we haven't yet figured out how to collect a set of passwords that that's representative of passwords that would be used in real life. The approach we followed to figure out how to get these representative sets of passwords was first to become really good friends with the IT and IT security people in our organization. So what this allowed us to do is collaborate with them where they would look at the passwords that were actually in use for real in our organization at Carnegie Mellon, and they would measure them in various ways that were useful to us. And then we would compare the measurements they took to the measurements that we took for passwords created under various other scenarios. So for example, passwords collected in online studies or in lab studies or subsets of passwords that have been leaked online. Of course, this was often more challenging than it might seem because we never had actual access to the passwords. We only handed over some algorithms to analyze the passwords to the people who actually had passwords. And then when those algorithms broke, there were some late night phone calls between somebody in a SCIF and somebody on our side trying to debug what exactly the algorithm was doing. And to cut to the chase, what we discovered is that passwords that are collected in carefully designed online user studies can be a good proxy for the passwords that people actually use to protect their real-world high-value accounts. We also found a bunch of entertaining, but perhaps less ultimately useful things. For example, we discovered that at our university, computer scientists make stronger passwords than engineers. I'm both a computer scientist and an engineer, so I hope the right side, half of me, is making my passwords. We also found out that both computer scientists and engineers make much, much better passwords than our business school faculty and students, unfortunately. Okay, so now we have a methodology. We know what to measure. We know how to generate sets of passwords that correspond to new ideas for password composition policies or new guidance in a way that's actually fairly representative of real passwords. So we went on and deployed that methodology in a number of studies. In fact, we conducted studies that spanned over 100,000 participants by this point. So a couple of insights we've gained from those studies. One is that in terms of password composition policies, length is almost strictly better than complexity for both security and usability. Not completely strictly because you have to mix in a little bit of complexity, just length isn't quite enough. Another thing that we learned is that blacklisting weak passwords is a must. No matter what password composition policy you decide to subject your users to, they will find some way to create some weak passwords. So you can't really rule those out using a password composition policy. You have to deploy another mechanism to rule them out. But at the same time, when you deploy that mechanism, you have to explain to users what's going on. Because if you start ruling out their passwords without explaining to them why, they're very likely to create just another password that your mechanism won't catch, but that will still be a pretty bad password. Finally, we found in general that giving users feedback when they're creating a password about whether this password is good and bad and why can be very helpful in nudging them to create passwords that are stronger. But at the same time, you can't try to nudge them too hard by, for example, telling them that their password is really terrible when it's actually kind of good, because eventually users will just start tuning out your feedback and doing whatever they want. So combining these insights with the neural network that I talked about that can efficiently and accurately measure password strength, we also developed an effective deployable password meter. Now we're all familiar with password meters, and this one looks from far away like many you've seen. It has a bar that represents password strength, and it has a set of advice about, in this case, very concrete advice about how to make your password better. But what's unique about this meter is that the design has been based on data and measurement, unlike pretty much every other meter out there. And we have evaluated the effectiveness of this meter and showed that it actually substantially increases password strength compared to passwords that are created without this kind of feedback. Okay, so that brings me to my actionable feedback. If you're a user, what can you do? Well, one thing you can do is not reuse passwords across accounts, because that's just the worst possible thing. Another thing is you can pick passwords that are longer. You shouldn't entirely forego complexity. You should mix in a symbol or a number if you can. Hopefully not just at the end, but maybe somewhere in the middle. Don't use your favorite pet's name in your password. No matter that nobody knows that you have a pet or your pet's name, there are probably many other people out there who also have pets, and some of them share the name of your pet. And so attackers will be guessing that as part of their strategy. Finally, you can forego a lot of pain and just use a password manager. And in particular, use the password manager's features for auto-generating passwords. And then, of course, you use the password manager to save the passwords, and you don't have to worry about remembering them. What can you do if you are an information security officer or you're in a similar role? Well, if you're considering what kind of password composition policy to deploy, you might want to relax the rules a little bit, but put in some sort of mechanism for weeding out the common passwords. You might also consider what kind of feedback you're going to give to users while they're creating a password, and there you can take a look at our meter and how we designed it, and perhaps be inspired by some of that. You also need to remember that your organization is not the only one for which people have to be creating a password, and so you shouldn't ask them to create a password in a way that they can't replicate on the many dozens of other accounts that they also have. Finally, what if you're a usable security researcher? Well, we spent a long time developing this methodology, which we have shown is an effective way of studying passwords. So if you're a passwords researcher, please use this methodology. If you're researching some sort of similar usability technology, again, our methodology might provide an inspiration. And if you're interested in evaluating different password schemes and want to evaluate the strengths of the passwords created under them, you might want to visit pgs.ec.cmu.edu and send us these passwords, and we'll report back on how strong they are. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So in our final 3 minutes, I want to ask each panelist to give me one other usable security research topic that they're excited about that they don't have time to tell you about in detail right now.
I'll go first. So the thing that I'm most excited about working on right now is trying to figure out how to help people understand the kinds of inferences that are possible from the data that they're providing to systems, which is actually really hard because most people don't even know what machine learning is, let alone the kinds of things it can do. And so what I've been trying to do is figure out ways to give them sort of little clues and hints and interfaces that help them to speculate about possible things that could be learned about them from their data.
So actually, somewhat connected to what I presented, we stepped back from our research, which was analyzing photos for privacy threats. And we said, well, what if we looked at just analyzing imagery just by itself, not thinking about the photo? Maybe you could help visually impaired people assess the privacy of their surroundings, right? And there's a lot of work looking at how you can help the visually impaired with navigation. But privacy seems to be a problem for another day, and so we kind of went in that direction, and we have a lot of work looking at, you know, what should we even infer from the environment? What are the needs of the visually impaired? And then what about the people, the bystanders to the assistive devices? They might be more accommodating to assistive devices, but even they have a limit of what they consider creepy, even for assistive applications. So we're kind of grappling with these questions, and it's been quite exciting.
So for me, something that I think is super exciting that's on the horizon follows actually a lot of what Emilee was talking about. I think we are now on the verge of being able to build systems, build intelligent assistants, which can help guide us through various privacy and security decisions that we make every moment practically when we're online, or even when we're offline and walking down the street which has cameras and other sensors pointed at us. I think we can now start to develop tools which will learn what our preferences are, learn what our habits are, maybe learn what kind of information we're missing in order to make the kinds of decisions that we want to make, or maybe learn what kind of consequences we're not aware of or need to be pointed out so that, again, we can make a decision that we're comfortable with.
And I myself am doing some work on making notice and consent for privacy usable and developing privacy and security nutrition labels for IoT devices. And with that, we will let you all go. Thank you.